Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Amen. Our text for today is the second reading in Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13 through chapter 5, verse 1. It begins on page 4 of the Bible. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Apostle Paul has been talking in this chapter about the weakness and frailty of human life. He's been talking about this great treasure that God has given us, but he reminds us that we hold this treasure in earthen jars, in clay jars. You know, dust of the earth, clay, perfect analogy. And perfect also because those clay jars can hold up under a lot of pressure. But because there may be a flaw here or there, they can't hold up under all pressure. It's very easy for them to become cracked or to break completely. The other perfect analogy that he uses here is the fact that those clay jars were nothing particularly beautiful. They were very plain and great. And so are you and me. There is nothing great and beautiful about us that should attract the Lord's love and mercy. We are sinners. We are weak. Weak not only in our earthly nature and fragile, but also very often as Christians, we struggle with faith. And Paul talks there in that first paragraph about those important things that God has provided for us. He speaks of trust, he speaks of testimony, and he speaks of thanksgiving. All of those are things that are important to the Christian life. But perhaps most importantly, he talks about the fact that we as Christians, weak though we may be, do not lose hope. Now, Paul knows what that's all about, because Paul has been through a number of things in his life, being beaten, shipwrecked, having to run out of town for fear of his life, all of those kind of things. He definitely knew what trials and tribulations were. And yet he also knew that the Lord God had called him for a special purpose, and that God would continue to provide for him so that he might be a witness to the love of God, so that he might be a very fit and perfect, useful witness to the love of God. And so it is for you and me. Very often, we too go through trials. And unfortunately, there are times when we forget that all of this is part of God making and shaping of us to bear witness to his mercy wherever we may go. Not only that our hearts can grow in faith, but also that we may proclaim that testimony to others. Indeed, we may lose a lot of things, but as Christians, we do not lose hope. We do not lose heart, because we know that we have seen the very heart of God in the person of Jesus Christ. When our hearts are broken, when we stand in grief and pain, when we struggle with things of faith, with things of the world, with things perhaps not knowing whether we've done enough or done the right thing, when we struggle with our very self, not only others, it is God who reminds us that we and earthly vessels, though we may be, he has given a great treasure into us. You see, those jars were not beautiful in any particular way in and of themselves. But they were beautiful and useful because of what was stored in them. I remind you of the Dead Sea Scrolls, which were discovered in clay jars, buried there for such a long, long time. And when they were discovered, and the scrolls were taken out, everything that we already knew and believed about the scriptures was backed up by those manuscripts. And we learned even more things than we had known before because of those manuscripts. There was a great treasure kept within those clay jars. God's gifts and talents or whatever it is in our life that we kind of take for granted and think it's humdrum. And yet, when God fills it with His own presence, He fills it with the greatest gift of all. He uses us as His servants to keep His word, and yet to serve by pouring out that word. And it's not as if we jars have to chip ourselves and go here and there. But God Himself takes hold of us and places us in the places where we need to be. And He chips us and pours out from us the good news of salvation in Jesus Christ. That is the greatest news that there could possibly be for any of us, for all time, and yet even eternity. The good news of God's love for all sinners in Jesus Christ. It is in His name that we have the restoration of life. It is in His name that we have the restoration of true hope and where we find our joy. It is in His name that we are able to move forward because we know that it's nothing about us. It's about God filling us with His treasure and God making use of us wherever we need to be. And so we do not lose heart. Perhaps from our human way of thinking, it would have been easy for God to lose heart. And because we often speak of the grief that God feels, which He does, over our sin, perhaps it's easy for us to think that He nearly lost heart when our first parent sinned. And all of creation was affected by that sin. Nothing was perfect anymore. Sin, death, and disease. Not a part of the world before sin, but because of sin, now, an ordinary part of life. Not what God had planned. And yet, I remind you once again this week that the plan of salvation was not a knee-jerk reaction by a panicked God. God, in His perfect foreknowledge, knew exactly what our first parents were going to do, and He knew exactly how it was going to play out in their life and yours and mine centuries later. And so, from eternity before life was called into existence, He prepared a way of salvation for you and for me. Our first parents were expelled from that garden, that they might not eat from the tree of life and live forever apart from God. And God then sent His own Son, born woman, born under the law, to live under the law, to bear up under temptation, and yet having perfectly kept His life, not deserving yet, then to offer His perfect life and sacrifice for our imperfect lives. Offer Himself because of His great love for you. Not because of anything in you or me. We're sinners. Come on. And yet, so great is His heart of love that He would not leave you alone but pass you on. The voice of God calls down through all generations. He speaks to us in His holy word, and He makes that word very personal and intimate as He touches our bodies with the word of water and the word of bread and wine and fills us with the very life of the risen Christ who has died and risen again and death no longer has a hold on Him. So too, it has no hold on you or me. We may go through the physical death, we may go through those crushing and perplexing times, we may go through all kinds of difficulties, but the life that He has given into us remains. No one can take that from us. The life that He has given to us remains, even through death, that those who live and believe in me shall never die. The great mercy of God, who who took heart and gives us heart in the message of salvation, in the way of salvation totally given for you and for me. That great God, we must always remember, is for us, not against us. He has proven it time and time and time again. But our sinful hearts tend to look at the difficulties, at the troubles, and whine and cry, why God? And you know what? He accepts that whining and crying out. He understands it completely. And he only longs for us to know his love more thoroughly. And so he sticks with us. That's really the love of God, isn't it? His commitment took him to the cross for you and for me. His commitment led him to descending into hell and proclaiming his victory over sin, death, and the devil. And so it is for you and for me, and indeed the gates of hell shall not prevail against his church. That's you and me. He has reached out his hand. He has made up, and he has filled us with the greatest gift there is. And he would use us throughout the world. In those times that we recognize as great opportunities, and in those times when we think we're only challenged, and in those times when we have no clue that it's even in time. But such is the blessing he gives to you and to me. To be the very instruments and tools of God. What an awesome gift is that? Have you ever really stopped to think about how awesome that is? The whole Christian faith about all of the gifts of God and his personal thoughts for you and for me is knowing everything about us and loving us more than we could ever imagine. His pouring out of his blood and washing away more sins than we could ever wrap up. His calling to us as sinners to come to him and be embraced the arms of grace. Those things are things that only the Holy Spirit can help us to understand. And so we rely upon them. We rely upon God and the work of the Spirit. We rely on those things that He reveals to our hearts. And we know that for those things that we do not understand, He gives us faith to simply believe, to grab hold, and move on with Him. Our life in this world. Our life with Christ forever. Our life with one another and with all God's people throughout the world. And yes, those who are alive with Him in heaven helps us to move forward. And with those things in mind, how could we lose heart? Well, because we're sinners. And that is where the blessing of God's strengthening word, the work of His Spirit, and the mutual consolation of the brethren comes into play. You see, you and I have the opportunity for God to pour out that grace from us for one another. And yet, for the salvation of the world to bear witness to Him. But it must begin here. It must begin with us remaining together, rejoicing in His commitment, and living in that commitment for one another. The Lord hath indeed shown His heart of love for you in the person of Jesus Christ. We may not know the mind of God, but we certainly know His heart. And never forget that it is a heart that is for you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Rejoicing in the hope of the resurrection that our Lord has given to us and all of His blessings, we stand and confess the ancient faith of the Church. Together with all God's faithful of every time and every place, we confess. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified and was crucified. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.